Now, I've been wanting to record this episode for probably 6 months to a year now. And it's taken me a while to get to the point where I can actually record it because I realized I had to go back and rewatch the entire show, well, pretty much the entire show to do this podcast. Now, the TV show, if you haven't already read the title, is 13 Reasons Why. Now, I'd be very surprised if you haven't heard about this show. Even though it came out in 2017, it was huge. Like, yes, it's based off a book that was like written in like 2007. And it was like a teen cult kind of book that, you know, I think it was well known, but it wasn't. The TV show was really what blew it the fuck up. And the show is basically about a girl called Hannah who comes to a new school and we basically follow the story of why she took her own life. Now, this podcast episode, while I will be discussing the plot, which revolves around mental health and suicide, it won't be the main focus of this episode. But again, still trigger warning, like if you don't want to listen to this episode, I completely understand. It is a very graphic show, which kind of leads me into the next point, that this show is highly controversial. Not only by the title that makes it so controversial, but obviously what happened in the show and how graphic it was made it controversial. I guess starting off with the title, 13 Reasons Why, its depiction of suicide is very negative and harmful, and there were lots of articles written at the time when this came out about how damaging this TV show was, not only the book but the TV show, because it made it seem like that suicide is used as a form of revenge, and it paints it in a really kind of salacious way. And yeah, the show was, you know, there was huge backlash, and the show ended up having to come out with all these like disclaimers and trigger warnings in front of all the episodes and after the episode like would air, like as kind of like a post roll, because there was just so much like young people watching and consuming this. And it's like, well, yes, it's being and you know, I'm sure the show creators were like, we're not targeting this to like 13-year-olds and under, but it's like kids were watching it. Like, it's just, it's a TV show about kids in high school. Like, people are going to watch that. Young people are going to watch that. So it's really reckless when you kind of put together a show about mental illness that's like incredibly graphic. Like, basically they ended up having to edit out the scene with Hannah taking her own life, and they also had to, I think, edit certain sexual assault scenes as well, kind of like making them less graphic as they originally were. I originally watched the show with those scenes unedited, and by far it is one of the most like graphic set of scenes I've ever seen. I was shocked. I was like, what the fuck? Like, I just don't really understand the point. Like, well, no, I understand why they did it. It's because if you're provocative, you're going to make money and you're going to get attention. While they probably thought that their intention was to kind of confront the viewer and be like, this is what mental illness is, and, you know, this is what bullying does to kids. It just, there's a point, there's a line that they crossed where it was like, you're not just doing this to prove a point. You're doing this because you know that it's provocative. And that's really reckless, I personally think. Like, while I know we can't completely control people's artistic direction, I do think to a point, like, have some common sense. Like, if you direct a TV show or you direct a movie, fucking use your brain, okay? Like, I just, yeah. And you know what? At the end of the day, it's like, yes, there are other violent shows and movies that exist, right? But I think the context of this show is what made it so controversial. The fact that it was like about kids in school, the fact that the writing in the TV show was so poorly done at times, the fact that it kind of perpetuated certain stigmas around mental health, you know? Like, it's one thing to be like, oh, we want violence because like violence is great, right? But it's like, it's another to like then add another layer of just like complete utter recklessness and like continuing to perpetuate certain stigmas that are just like really harmful to society, right? And that's kind of what 13 Reasons did. It while there are kind of like a portion of people who love the show and think they can kind of like see that, yes, it did things that were maybe a bit too much, but like ultimately it was still an important show. It started conversations around mental health and suicide that maybe otherwise wasn't there enough. And then there is obviously a massive portion of people who are like, this show never should have been done. It's shit. End of story. Now, this podcast episode is not about, I know I just spoke about briefly the controversial nature of this show, but my podcast is not going to be about analyzing the TV show around its mental health and all that kind of stuff. Because I actually think a lot of people have already done that since the show came out. And I think people have done it really well. I think everything that needs to be said has been said. But there's just one thing for me about this show that I could never really put my finger on it. And then it wasn't until I watched it one more time that I was like, okay, that's my final point on the show that I actually think is an important takeaway. Now, I'm never watching this show again. The fact that I've had to rewatch it literally irritates me because like it was so like the amount of shit in this show that's just boring. And I was like skipping through certain parts. I was like, oh my God, yes, yes, we get it, blah, blah, blah. And then like the other really traumatic scenes, I was like, ew, I don't want to see this. Like, this is just fucked up. Like, I don't need this in my mental energy, you know? So it was not fun rewatching the show at all. And just to be clear, I only rewatched season one and season two because that's all that I think is really important to this discussion. I did not bother rewatching season three and season four, which I would argue are fucking shit, okay? This show is on the same token as like something like Riverdale, right? It's like they get writers who think they know how kids talk, and it's so contrived and it feels so forced, and it's just like, it's just cringe. Like kids don't talk like that. Like it's like they're talking like these like vigilantes that just like know what's right, and like it's just like, oh Jesus. like I feel like I finished 13 Reasons Why and just was like, this is why you don't give kids BMWs and fucking AK-47s, because like seriously, they like that's what the show is, really. It's just kids taking shit into their own hands even when they don't know jack. Like, it's just ugh. So no, let me come back to the ground a little bit here, because I've gone on a bit of a tangent in this introduction. I will be focusing on Clay Jensen's character. Now, he is kind of like the, I guess, protagonist alongside Hannah's character, in the sense that he is kind of the storyteller, the narrator of season one and I guess season two. And season one, of course, follows the 13 reasons why Hannah decided to take her own life. Now, again, I don't condone the plot of this narrative, but for the sake of me explaining Clay Jensen, I have to do it. I apologize. Anyway, so we go through season one watching Clay go through all the tapes that Hannah left behind. Now, the reason I was so drawn to Clay Jensen's character, I think initially, was just like there was something off about him. So on a surface level, he's just a boy, a simple boy, who loves Hannah and who cared about Hannah and wants to do right by Hannah now that she's passed away. And it seems like this meaningless crush, right? Like the first time you watch it, you're just kind of like, okay, this boy just has a crush on this girl. But I would argue that Clay Jensen's character is a lot more complicated than maybe people give him credit for. Because I would argue that the show is just, again, not well done. But Clay Jensen's character, and maybe that's the actor also bringing something to the table, is actually really well done when it comes to showing another side of how negatively that kind of nice guy and insecure and saviorist complex that men can have on women and how that can be really damaging. Because while in the show, we're given all the other archetypes of shitty men, right? We're given, you know, the men who like rape and abuse women. We're given men who are dismissive. We're given men who are slut shamers. We're given men who bully. We're given the like classic toxic masculinity that is, you know, usually portrayed in most movies and TV shows when it comes to like that kind of man, right? That has a really negative impact on women. But the thing about Clay is his character is a lot more complicated than that, because while on the surface he seems like this like nice, like just wants the best, he's actually got some really like toxic traits that feed into the slut shaming, that feed into the rape culture, that feeds into Hannah feeling not worthy, to Hannah's low self-esteem, to Hannah's self-hatred, to Hannah feeling abandoned. And obviously we follow Clay not really understanding throughout season one how he's played a part in Hannah's suicide. And obviously, again, I don't condone that plot line. I think that's really reckless to say that, you know, that is suicide. But what I think it does is we see someone really reflect on their actions. And that is a great concept. Everything else is totally reckless. But the idea that we're watching a young man kind of reflect on his behavior throughout season one and season two is really effective, I personally think. And the thing is, they do it in a way that's actually realistic, because it's not like Clay gets kind of like checked in like episode one being like, hey mate, that's actually really like slut-shamey and like not cool that you like projected that onto Hannah. Like, cut it out. And then Clay goes, yeah, you're right, I actually shouldn't do that. It's like, no, we actually see a lot of little moments sprinkled throughout season one and season two where Clay is continuously feeding into a kind of like insecure man who's like projecting that onto Hannah. Like, we're constantly seeing that throughout season one and season two. And I think it's so important when you're telling a story about the shit ways that men can treat women, both in an overt way and like a more subtle way, because those subtle ways are so insidious. And it's so, and the problem is it's never called out in the same way. And obviously overt ways of like sexism and all that kind of slut shame, misogynistic crap is awful. Like, I fucking hate it myself. But those subtle ways are usually the things that get swept under the rug, and people don't really call it out, and people don't even notice or acknowledge it sometimes. So when I rewatched the show, I kind of was like, okay, from season one to the end of season two, I'm going to write down every single moment that I notice Clay kind of doing the thing that is really insidious, which is kind of like projecting his insecurity, his ownership over Hannah, his toxic crush over Hannah, his like internal slut shaming of Hannah onto Hannah. Like, I was like, I'm just gonna like really only focus on that dynamic, because I was like, that's, to me, that was like a hugely important story that was going to be told, and everything else was just fucking fluff. Now, is the TV show worth it in the end just for Clay Jensen's storyline that I think is actually really well done? No. I don't think the show should ever have been done in the way that it was. Could it have ever been done in any kind of way? No, because I don't really fundamentally agree with the book. Like, I feel like if that's the seed, the tree ain't going to be great either. Like, it's just, no, I just fundamentally think that the way it portrays mental health is just fucking stupid. But alas, I want to focus on the Clay Jensen thing, because I actually think it has an important thing about. Okay. From the very start, yes, we're given this idea that Clay has a crush on Hannah, or that he feels immense feelings towards her but doesn't want to reveal that to her. And it's kind of like this playful high school crush thing, which I'm sure so many people can relate to, and maybe especially like teenage boys, right? Not knowing how to express how they feel because they're not taught how to do that. But right from the get-go in episode one, we see Clay already judging Hannah as a young woman. we're already seeing it. And the way he's doing it is Hannah goes on a date with another boy from the school. And Clay's just like, why would she ever go on a date with that guy? And while it may seem like harmful jealousy, he's actually internalizing this idea that, like, why would Hannah put herself in a situation with another boy like that? As if Clay has some kind of ownership over her. And I think from the very start, it's like we're already getting this, like, kind of toxic, like, internal dialogue from Clay, which later he kind of starts verbalizing to other people who call it out. But it's like, because we're in his thoughts, it's like, you're just like, eh, like, really, Clay? Like, that's just not cool. And so Hannah mentions on the tapes that Clay is listening to, she kind of points out that the people on the tape maybe have done something cruel or watched it happen, in reference to the bullying and the harassment. And the thing about Clay is he really is your classic bystander. And again, I think portraying bystanders in the way that they did with Clay is so well done. And it's such a shame that it was kind of tainted by the TV show in general. But they really show the negative impact that bystanders can have on someone's mental well-being. And I think sometimes we focus so much on, like, the provokers and the bullies, right? But there are so many people in this life who just kind of stand idly by and let things happen, and they don't leverage their own power. And that's something we see throughout season one and season two, is Clay so often doesn't want to leverage his own power because of his own insecurities. And it's kind of frustrating to watch, because there are other moments where he, you know, so-called leverages his power for Hannah's sake, but it's because he's trying to fulfill some saviorist complex. It's not because he actually is leveraging his power for other people. It's to self-indulge and to feel masculine in certain moments. And so from the get-go, from episode one, we really don't see Clay leverage his power at all for Hannah, even though he claims that Hannah is a friend. You know, whether or not he has a crush on Hannah, he claims that they are friends. Yet when he sees that a photo, an explicit photo, has been shared around of Hannah, as you know, gross men have been in her high school, just like, you know, they have a photo, they share it around, disgusting, right? Clay does not console Hannah as a friend. Clay does not shut down the photo. In fact, he looks at the photo at one point, and he chooses to judge Hannah rather than actually look at that photo and go, this is horrible, are you okay, like, do you need anything, as a friend, right? No, but instead he chooses to judge her. Anyway, then we get to episode three. Clay continues to watch Hannah be objectified throughout her high school and does nothing but to continue to judge it. And the reason Clay's character is so kind of realistic, but also a really negative impact on Hannah and maybe any kind of young woman, is he balances his judgment with pure infatuation for Hannah. So Hannah's character, but also maybe this could be a real life situation. Imagine someone is saying, I love you, but I also really judge you. And I judge everything that you've done in your past. I judge who you are now as a person. And I actually think deep down that you've made really bad decisions. That is going to have a really negative impact. And I've seen it time and time again with people in my own life, right? Where it's like a man will say, I love you, but I judge you for X, Y, and Z. Because what they're really saying is, I love the idea of you, but I don't fully accept you for who you are. And that obviously plays a huge negative impact on Hannah's self-esteem and self-loathing, because this person who claims to be her friend, who secretly loves her, is also judging her and playing into that slut-shaming narrative that the school and her peers are kind of creating about her. So in episode 3, there's this thing called the hot list that gets created and passed around. And Hannah gets put on this list, and it's for her bum, basically. And Clay reads this hot or not list or whatever it is, and continues to pass it around. And he reads it and acknowledges it, and he just gives it to the next person and kind of judges her for it, right? And Clay admits that he doesn't really understand why Hannah was affected by that list. He's like, so what? She was put on the, you know, the good side, and they said that she had a nice ass. Like, who cares, right? And completely misses the point that it's like, it's not a compliment. The boys in her class were objectifying her amongst other women and putting down other women. Like, the fact that Clay was kind of like not seeing that, and yet he still continues to portray himself as not like the other guys. Like, he's like, no, but I don't, you know, I don't rape and I don't bully and I don't do anything like that. So I'm a good guy. I'm the nice guy. Yet he continues to ignore the way that Hannah was treated and objectified, and that he played a part in that. And so again, I think it's really important that we see these types of characters written, because I think it's a really great way to hold up a mirror. Because I actually think the show was self-aware in Clay's character, that they knew that he was problematic. They knew that, and they wrote him that way to kind of highlight that it's not just the dickhead jocks that made Hannah feel horrible. It's also the nice guy who thought that he treated Hannah equally, but really he objectified her, he judged her, and he treated her like shit internally, and that projected it outwardly onto her. So I truly think that more characters need to be written like that, because I actually think it says so much about, you know, I think it teaches people really how to see things from all perspectives. And then we go to episode 4, right? So again, this is where what I think that Clay is doing really at this point. He's undermining his worth to Hannah to excuse how he treated her. So if Clay keeps telling himself that he's, you know, a piece of shit, that he's a nobody, that, you know, he's just a lame, nice guy kid that, you know, was never going to get with Hannah, then I feel like in a way he's able to rationalize how he treated her, because he's like, well, I made no impact on her life anyway. She probably didn't even notice me. It's like, no, but Hannah did notice you, and Hannah did see you as a friend, and Hannah did see you as a potential romantic partner. But you constantly projected your insecurities onto her, and you constantly put this barrier up against you two, where you saw her in a way that you created an idea of her. You didn't see her for who she truly was. And a really sad thing that we learn in episode 4 is that that Clay did overtly sexualize Hannah, and you know, he reflects upon that and he feels disgusted with himself that he did that. But it's again one of those important moments where we actually see Clay reflecting on that, but he doesn't become a perfect person, and he still makes mistakes along the way, which I think is really good, because it doesn't mean that he's like changed overnight. It's like, no, he's slowly recognizing patterns of behaviors that he did that were wrong, but again, he's not going to change overnight. He still needs to learn these like little things that he keeps doing that is problematic. So in episode 5, we see this really kind of, there are tender moments between Clay and Hannah, where we kind of do get to see them in the light of these like young teenagers who have a little bit of a crush on each other and a bit awkward around each other. And I think those moments are really powerful because they're real. Like, I, as someone who went through high school and went through those awkward moments with crushes and all that kind of thing, it felt real. And those moments did feel relatable in that sense. And I think those tender moments are important because it's where we get to see the positive sides of Clay, and that Clay really thought he did love Hannah as a person, but we obviously slowly start to realize, and so does Clay, that he loved this idea of her, and then slowly in the end, I think he does end up loving and accepting her as a person and not judging her, but I'll get to that. But these tender moments, we do see a kind of an innocence in Clay and an innocence in Hannah, that they are just these two teenagers that, you know, are trying to connect. And this is where the song The Night We Met became really famous, and this kind of became their, you know, their song. And again, I think it's this really emotional scene that they have together at this formal, as they kind of like interact with each other. And I think it makes it really powerful, actually, in their dynamic as a whole. But it doesn't take away from the fact that Clay still views her as somewhat of an object of his fantasy. I would almost say that Clay's character and his insecurities and the way that he projects that onto Hannah is very similar to a character from Normal People by Sally Rooney, Connell. I feel like Connell is probably a lot more well-written, and I mean, that story, Normal People, I'd say, is a lot more well-written in general about mental health and this kind of like phenomenon of the nice guy who's also a negative as well. I feel like that's Connell. He did so much to treat Marianne like shit, right? In Normal People, like, and it was because of his insecurities. It doesn't excuse what he did, but ultimately we can sympathize and empathize with Connell because he was insecure and he was dealing with anxiety and depression, yada yada, right? And you could argue the same with Clay, right? It's like there are things that he did to Hannah because he was insecure and he was anxious himself. But again, I think Connell is a lot better written and shows that we can write better stories, and we don't need shows like 13 Reasons Why to do it. But again, I continue to argue that Clay Jensen is still a well-done character and is pushing a narrative that we need to see more of because it's a teaching moment. Anyway, also Clay, this show makes me cringe sometimes. Clay fucking used the term Orwellian, like Orwellian nightmare. I just was like, this show is so contrived. Like, I just can't. Like, what fucking teenager is using Orwellian? Anyway, episode 6. We see this whole Dollar Valentine storyline where basically the kids at the school get to like find out who their Valentine is. And we kind of see Clay pretending to not want to be Hannah's Valentine, but also projecting that he's annoyed that she's not his Valentine. And it's just this constant frustration where we see Clay not be honest about how he feels towards Hannah, even though Hannah has like kind of expressed that she enjoys being around Clay. But again, Clay is just so unwilling to just like be vulnerable and be honest with Hannah. Then episode 7 is kind of a huge turning point for Clay in terms of like where we really see him escalate as this like nice guy on the surface, but deep down is really like slut shaming Hannah. And it's him realizing that Hannah had an intimate relationship with Zach, which we actually find out more in season 2, and I'll get to that. But this is where he first realizes that Hannah and Zach, another boy at the school, have a kind of like relationship. And the way that Clay gets angry is so frustrating as a woman to watch. Because again, the way that Clay is getting angry at Hannah and judging Hannah for having a innocent like time with this boy, and she has feelings for Zach, and she wants to like explore that with Zach, and it's the way that Clay judges her is so infuriating, because it's like you are not telling Hannah that you like her, then you want to be with her. So don't judge Hannah for going off and wanting to like be romantic with other people who are openly telling her that they you know are interested or whatever. Like, it's just so frustrating that he's projecting that anger onto her and judging her continuously for having experiences with other guys. And it's just like, she is well within her right to do that. Like, don't get angry at her. Don't slut shame her. Like, what are you doing? And then on the same token, you're claiming that you love her. And it's just bullshit. You're infatuated with her. And you love the idea of her, but you don't truly accept who she is. And just seeing this kind of self-righteous, like, character of Clay and the way that he's getting angry at Zach for having this moment with Hannah is just so frustrating to watch. But so important, because again, we see this kind of unveil Clay's nice guy persona. And then episode 8, we get a moment where Clay reads a poem that Hannah wrote, but he didn't know Hannah wrote it. And Clay says to Hannah, "I like her poem, but I'm not sure I would want to hang out with her." And obviously he doesn't know that the poem was written about Hannah, or written by Hannah, about her like mental well-being. But it's this idea that it doesn't even matter that Clay doesn't know that this was written about Hannah. It's the fact that he's still judging the woman on that page that he's reading. And it says so much about who he is, that he claims to be this person who cares and he claims to be this person that loves Hannah, yet he is judging a woman who's expressing her feelings on a page. And she's not perfect and she's not this virginal princess that he's kind of creating of Hannah. Because that's the thing, right? He's projecting this idea that Hannah's this innocent virginal princess. And if people taint that idea of her, he gets angry and his toxic masculinity fucking flies out of him. And that's sad to watch. Episode 9. Again, we get these tender moments between Clay and Hannah that I think are really realistic and really relatable, where Clay and Hannah are kind of interacting at this like house party. And again, I think this is really important for their dynamic. Because I do think it's important that as a viewer, we still sympathize with Clay and that we recognize that he is flawed and he's problematic, but ultimately he is wanting to be a better person. And we also, I do believe that Clay saw Hannah as a friend. I don't think Clay was a very good friend to Hannah, but at this point, I still think he loves the idea of her and doesn't actually fully accept her as a person. Episode 10, we get an overt reaction from Clay that is really negative and harmful towards Hannah. As soon as Hannah somewhat rejects Clay romantically because she's dealing with some trauma, but Clay is unaware of this, not that it should matter. As soon as Hannah somewhat rejects Clay, Clay lashes out at Hannah, which is just a classic and really insidious thing that men can do to women that I'm sure most have experienced before, where when they don't get what they want, that then their true selves kind of come out a little bit. I think I've told this story before, but I was once on the street minding my own damn business and this man comes up to me and he's like, "Oh, can I have your phone number? Like, what's your name?" And I just was like, "No, like, I'm not interested." And he's like, "Yeah, well, you're a fucking bitch anyway. And like, why the fuck would I want to talk to you?" Do I need to explain my point any further? Like, yeah, this is a constant battle that women are dealing with on a daily basis. The bullshit, right? It's like, yeah, you're all nice and fine when, you know, you get what you want. But as soon as you don't, then apparently we're a bitch and we're a slut. And yeah. So again, that's why I think Clay is such a brilliant character in the sense that he's really showing the audience, being like, see, he thinks he's the nice guy, but really he's just a fucking prick sometimes as well. And that's something that he has the potential to be a good person. And I do actually think that he is somewhat of a good person, but it really does hold up a mirror and say, but check your fucking problematic behavior and check your fucking toxic masculinity and fucking reel it the fuck in. And stop projecting your fucking insecurities. Sorry, I'm getting a little passionate now. so then we get to episode 11 where Clay ultimately listens to his tape, his reason why Hannah took her own life. Again, do not condone the plot. I think the plot is terrible. But ultimately, we hear why Clay is on the tapes. Basically, we find out that the reason he's on the tapes is because he... Well, we already kind of... I mean, I feel like the show is trying to set it up as we think Clay's done something overtly horrible, but that's not what's happened. Clay was just a bystander. Clay abandoned Hannah. Clay wasn't there for Hannah. Clay played into the idea that Hannah wasn't good enough for him. Even though he felt like he wasn't good enough for her, he ultimately made her feel like she wasn't good enough for him because ultimately he was internally slut-shaming her. Anyway, so we find out that basically the reason that he's on the tapes is because he abandoned her as a friend and as a potential romantic partner. Then episode 12... We get, again, portrayals of toxic masculinity things coming out of Clay, where Bryce, who raped Hannah in the show, basically says to Clay to provoke him, your crush wasn't pure and clean. Now, this obviously provokes Clay, but not in the way that I think it should provoke him. And we see that. Clay should be angry that Bryce said something like that, as if that means anything. Because it doesn't matter. What is this bullshit, pure and clean? Like, it's feeding into some misogynistic bullshit, right? And we want Clay to just be angry because he just shouldn't say shit like that and fuck Bryce, right? But no, I think the reason Clay is angry that Bryce said that is because his idea of Hannah is this virginal princess who is innocent, who is clean, who is pure, right? So that still perpetuates this fucking idea that he loves that idea of her, that is the sum of women, that we're these pure Virgin Marys, right? And that's hard to watch as a woman, because it's like, God damn it, don't be angry because Bryce is shattering this idea that Hannah is this pure virgin. Be angry because he fucking raped her and that he's a fucking scumbag, and it doesn't matter what his portrayal of Hannah is. It doesn't matter. Hannah's a human. Ugh, gets me angry. And look, yes, do we see Clay be angry at Bryce for sexually assaulting Hannah? Yes, we do. We see that anger. But I would argue that anger is coming from a place of saviorist, kind of that savior complex that Clay kind of really gets into season two. I think that's really where it comes out more. Like season one, I would say it's more focused on his insecurities projected onto Hannah and that negative impact. But we really start to see his fucking savior's complex later on. And I would say that this is to alleviate his sense of insecurity and like help his masculinity. Like I feel like that's why he kind of becomes this like saviorist, is because he feels like that's a way to cope with feeling insecure. He's like, okay, I'm gonna save the broken women in my life, because we see again that he ultimately tries to do that with other women in his life. So again, many frustrating moments from Clay. Episode 13. Clay says this really problematic shit. He said, I cost a girl her life because I was too afraid to love her. Again, deeply problematic sentiment. Really shows where the writing was at with this TV show. And as much as I'm giving a focus of Clay Jensen's character, I do think that a lot of the writing is just still fucking awful and problematic. Okay, season two. Again, This is where Clay's character kind of shifts a little. And in season two, we follow the court case against the school. because basically Hannah's parents claim that the school is the reason that that they could have done something to help Hannah in terms of the bullying and the harassment. And it's no longer about the tapes necessarily. That was kind of the plot of season one. But season two is really focused on this trial. And instead of getting flashbacks with Hannah and Clay, we're getting Clay and the ghost of Hannah. I know. It's so fucking stupid and poorly written. But this is just hang with me. So season two, episode one, we jump right back into Clay's internal slut-shaming of Hannah. Clay cannot fathom that Hannah would have ever sexted another boy. And he's so judgmental and in denial about it. And this anger that comes over him is just so insidious. Like, it's just really, like, it's really off-putting, actually, as a woman to watch that. Because, I think we've had so many interactions with guys who kind of portray themselves as nice and respectful of women. But then as soon as they just don't like the idea of something, they turn it into anger and they turn it into, episode two, Clay continues to show this, like, savior complex, in his relationship with Sky, who is also another girl that is dealing with really bad mental health. And again, Clay just can't see that she needs help that's not him. And, like, Clay is just constantly trying to save people, but, like, not in the way that he should. And Sky actually says that at one point to Clay, which I think is really powerful. That it's probably the only well-written line in the show. Because, yeah, Sky pretty much says, like, you really could help people. You just don't know, like, the way that you should, basically. Because Clay is kind of, like, your ultimate, like, vigilante. Like, he kind of just, like, fucking goes off and settles the justice himself. Which, like, you're a fucking kid, like, call the cops, tell your parents, like, what the fuck, like, you don't take matters into your own hands. But that is Clay Jensen's character. And ultimately, in episode three of season two, we see that Clay just wants to save Sky as some kind of retribution for what happened to Hannah. And, even the way that Clay talks to Jessica, another female student at the school who was friends with Hannah at a period of time, and who was also unfortunately sexually assaulted by one of the students at the school, Bryce, the way that Clay talks to Jessica about her sexual assault, again, is so deeply problematic, even though you could argue that Clay is wanting the best. He wants justice. He wants Jessica to testify in order to help Hannah, to help victims, blah, 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 right? But Clay's forcefulness with Jessica about her assault is so problematic, because it's like, it's not just simple getting up on the stand and talking about it. And the way that Clay frames it, he makes it seem like it is that simple. But it's like, no, it's actually deeply traumatic and deeply personal and hard and emotional. It's not simple. And you're not this person that just needs to save me in this moment or save Hannah in this moment. And yeah, I just, again, I think these scenes are really important, because it holds up a mirror to say, yeah, maybe you want the best for a woman in your life, but trying to, like, save her in a kind of forceful way, and like a, I don't know, just like a, in a way that you're disregarding the emotion and tenderness that is required, is really important to see. Anyway, so episode three, we hear Clay hears that Hannah had kissed Alex before, a male student at the school. And again, we see this overwhelming anger come out of Clay, where he's just like, I think he says to the ghost of Hannah, you have kissed everyone at this school, in a really judgmental tone. And a tone where it's like, I thought I knew you. Yeah, Clay, you thought you knew the idea of Hannah, which again is this virgin innocent princess or whatever the fuck. And if anyone taints that, you lose your shit, which is really fucking harmful. Episode 4, Clay hears about Hannah and Bryce, who ultimately is the one who sexually assaults Hannah. He hears that they had some kind of interaction that was, you know, somewhat friendly and romantic before anything had happened. And again, Clay lashes out and he goes, I thought I knew Hannah. And it's so sad that Clay kind of places this idea that he thinks he knew her in the sense of her sexuality. Like, everything else doesn't matter. The fact that they talked about their favorite TV shows, the fact that they talked about what hobbies they have, what dreams they have. He disregards all those beautiful interactions he had with Hannah, because the moment that he thinks he doesn't know her sexuality and her intimate moments with other people, that's what shatters his idea of her. And then he claims that he doesn't know her, even though he's had this entire friendship with her where they've had conversations and deep moments with each other. He throws that all away because, God forbid, her sexuality is anything but the Virgin Mary. Episode 5, again, we see Clay get angry at Hannah once again, because Hannah ultimately is forgiving of Justin, who is the dickhead guy from season 1, episode 1, who shares around the explicit photo of her and treats her like shit. Garbage boyfriend. And Clay has this whole thing where he's like, I don't understand why girls like Hannah get with guys like Justin. Again, fucking blaming Hannah and blaming women for so-called choosing shitty guys and not nice guys like Clay. It's like, please. Like, do you not see how fucking problematic that is? Episode 6, we revisit the Hannah and Zach thing. So we learn that Hannah and Zach actually have quite a deep relationship over the summer. And Clay finds out about this. And Clay finds out that Hannah actually has this really positive sexual experience with Zach and that she's actually quite happy with Zach. And Clay was away that summer, so he didn't know about any of this. And when he finds out about it, because it comes out in the court case, because all these kids are fucking testifying and the school is, you know, on trial, Clay gets angry. And even though... He finds out that Hannah had a positive sexual and romantic experience with Zach, and he gets angry, as if that's a bad thing. Like, the fact that Clay's anger is the same when he hears that she's been assaulted and the same as when he hears that she's had a positive sexual experience, that is what's wrong. Because Clay should not be reacting in the same way, in the same level of anger. But guess what? He still is objectifying her to a degree. He's still creating an idea of her that he is infatuated with her, yet he judges her. Again, it's so bad that he's doing that, but it's such a real experience for women. Episode 7, we get a really good, important conversation between Clay and Justin. Because Clay says some dumb slut-shaming thing towards Hannah and something in the past. And Justin kind of calls out and is like, I have slept with so many women and no one cared. And if anything, people championed me at school as a jock, you know, as the guy that got a lot of, you know, women. But Hannah... the society, the community finds out that Hannah's had a couple of sexual experiences and suddenly she's a slut. Like, that is the epitome of, you know, being a woman. It's just, you know, people find out you've kissed more than two people and suddenly, oh, she gets around. And Justin kind of points this out to Clay because he's like, you're being a fucking idiot. Like, the way that you're viewing Hannah and this idea of promiscuity is just fucking archaic and stupid and backwards and misogynistic. Oh, episode 8. This is where Skye reminds Clay that he can help people, just not in the way he thinks. And again, very true. Very, kind of the only well-written line in this whole show. Episode 9, nothing happened. So I was taking notes while doing this whole, like pick apart of Clay Jensen's character. And there would just be times I would be, like, holding, writing in my notepad, and I would literally just write, this show is so fucking boring, I want to stop watching it. Like, it's just, like, between my notes about important shit, I just was like, oh, I'm so bored. But yeah, there were just really boring times. Clay continues to be this like saviorist, and he learns about this thing called the clubhouse, which is where jocks and like dickhead boys from like sport dudes from the school would take women into this like shed and like get them high or drunk and then sometimes sexually assault them. Fucking disgusting. And Clay does the classic victim blaming sentiment. Of course he does. And Clay says, why did the girls get themselves into these situations anyway? Again, really, really frustrating, Clay, that you would say these things. And again, he finds out that Hannah went to the clubhouse. And what does he think? He judges her. And he can't comprehend why Hannah would get herself into the situation like that. And I know that you're probably thinking, like, these are kind of, like, simple victim-blaming sentiments that we've seen on TV before, right? But why I think it's so powerful coming from a character like Clay is because we get so many moments where he portrays himself as this nice, good guy. And I think it's important that we see two truths being held at the same time, where it's like, no, there can be good men out there, but sometimes even some good men do really problematic shit and they need to fucking like reassess. And while I don't think that at the end of season 2 we see Clay be this like perfect person in the end, like he's definitely not completely rid of all his problematic traits, but you really do see someone who's like actually reflected and assessed about how he's like treated Hannah and how he views victims and how he views himself, especially. In episode 13, end of season 2, it's the funeral of Hannah and the trial is over and the school ultimately won in the end. And there was no real justice for Hannah, I guess. But we get this, you know, final speech from Clay at her funeral where he finally admits openly that he loved her and that he needs to let her go, and that he finally gets to a point where I do think he forgives and is unconditionally loves Hannah. I don't think that he's perfect in the end. I don't think that he is fully rid of his internal slut-shaming tendencies, but I do think there is a tenderness and a real love that he had for Hannah. That is very real when you're a teenager and you're having those first feelings for someone. They feel so powerful and all-consuming. And I do believe that that is what Clay was experiencing. But I guess what's really important to remember is that you can be infatuated with someone and you can claim that you love them, but if you judge them and if you don't accept them for who they are and if you project your insecurities onto them, that's not good. And that really needs to change. And I think I've seen, you know, obviously, I think any woman, we're constantly re-evaluating men that we interact with and how they treat women and how they treat us. And I think obviously there has been generational change, and the way that women are being treated is better in certain cases, but there are still many instances where there are those subtle moments with the so-called nice guy, or the guy that claims that he respects women, that has outbursts or has moments of some real judgment and slut shaming, and they will always be so painful to experience as a woman, because we find it so hard to trust already that men are going to treat us in a certain way. So when we're given a guy that, you know, claims to be something and then really there's something else, it is really just so devastating. And I think that we need to see more characters written like Clay and kind of dissected and pulled apart. And we need to see those character evolutions, because ultimately I do think that art and TV and books can help culture, and it can help communities, and it can help society reevaluate and to hold up a mirror. And I, you know, we also need to have these discussions, and we need to be having these conversations. And again, I don't think that 13 Reasons Why is a groundbreaking show. I don't think it should ever really have been done, especially in the way that it was done. But I guess my only takeaway was how brilliant Clay Jensen's character was, and the way that you can really reflect on that nice guy phenomenon. And yeah, that's my takeaway from 13 Reasons Why. Also, I had to watch this on Netflix, and Netflix have now put fucking ads on. Don't get me started. It's like, now I have to pay for more so I don't get fucking ads. But it's like, I don't want to pay more. I'm already paying for your streaming service. Anyway, yeah, I was not happy about that. But yeah, I guess that's just where we're at.